Well, YouTube, this is my not-so-fancy, not-massive walk-in closet, which is perfectly fine for me, but my wife's closet is the same size, and well, we gotta do better than that. So in this video, we're gonna build a big built-in armoire or wardrobe or whatever you wanna call it, with more room for hanging clothes, a bunch of drawers, and a pull-out drawer to hide away a dirty clothes hamper. My thinking is, we don't plan on living here forever, so by building a nice unit that's built into the room, that might help future potential buyers get over the size of the other closets as well. I will have full build plans available for this, linked down in the video description. A ton of you might not have the same problem we do, but of course you don't have to add a rod and use it for clothes. It can just be a regular built-in with open shelving on the sides, or whatever you want. But this project started with just a ton of breaking down plywood, and rather than watch me cut every single piece, I'll go ahead and go over some of the tools I'm using. This is the TSO Products Rail Square, which I used with my Makita tracks as well. And now your mileage may vary here because I've heard that this does not work with the Milwaukee tracks, but all I can say is mine attaches just like on the Makita and cuts dead on square every time. Now over on the table saw, these gypsum stock guides on the fence aren't cheap, but man, a product that improves accuracy and safety is definitely worth it. If you aren't familiar with these, they provide pressure on your material downwards, and the wheels are canted, so they constantly keep your material pulled tight to the fence as you push it through. Really nice to have, especially trying to cut bigger sheets of plywood on a table saw. Links to all this stuff, along with everything else you see throughout the video, will be down in the description if you want to check them out more. With all the box parts cut to size, we can start putting these things together. Most of the sides aren't visible in the finished product, and that goes for most cabinets in general, so no need to overcomplicate things here, just glue and brad nails to hold the pieces while I drive a couple screws to really pull things tight. You can see I'm trying to minimize the amount of plywood as well to save on cost by just using stretchers to join the side panels rather than full pieces. The two outside cabinets are just slightly different. Since the outside panel will be visible along with the front of the inside panel, I'm using pocket hole screws here to attach the stretchers from the inside. Notice that I've made the outside panel about a quarter inch oversized as well along the back. This is just extra material built right in that will allow me to scribe the side of the cabinet tight to the wall when I go to install them. With the three base cabinets assembled, next up was the two tall upper cabinets. And since both sides of these will be visible in the finished product, it's all hidden pocket holes here to get them assembled. With all five of the boxes assembled, moving right along to making the face frames out of some 3/4 inch poplar. Since this is a built-in and I'll have the baseboard trim wrap around it, the bottom rails on the base cabinets are wider to account for that, and then the top of the upper cabinets are wider for the crown molding. There's a lot of different ways to attach face frames, but since this is going to be painted, a handful of brad nails that can be filled will do the trick. but I did use a mix of clamps as well where it was easy, just to save from having to fill as many nail holes. At this point, I was really running out of room in the shop, so I went ahead and broke down the material for the drawer boxes and the center panels for the door and drawer fronts. Now that I had some much-needed room recovered, I could get these things staged and see how it was looking. In between the base cabinets and uppers, I'm using one long panel to span the distance, and with some video magic, here we have our panel. The very first thing I actually did to start the project, just off camera real quick, was gluing these four boards together to make the panel. Cabinets are relatively quick to put together, so I wanted to make sure I had this ready to go with plenty of time to dry, so all I had to do was cut it down to size here. Here I'm gluing and nailing on the face frame material to the long shelf that connects the two upper cabinets, the top balance piece that the crown molding attaches to, and a couple small shelves that go inside the two cabinets. Not gonna lie, the shelves inside the cabinets were kind of an afterthought, or I probably would have used something other than pocket holes to attach them. But there's a lot of height above where the closed rod would be reachable, so might as well add some shelves for storage. I am putting the pocket holes on the top side though, where you can't see them unless you're like 8 feet tall. And I did plug the holes as well, so nothing gets snagged on them, sliding stuff on and off the shelf. For the center shelf and the top valance panel, I decided to add some threaded inserts to use bolts to attach them through the cabinets for a nice, struggle-free installation. I didn't have the right length of bolts on hand here yet, but was good enough to tell it was going to work out and everything lined up as it should. Up next was cutting all the material for the doors and drawer fronts to size, again using 3/4 inch poplar. For the joinery here, I'm using a Freud shaker style router bit set with the slight bevel on the inside edge. With this being a built-in, I just wanted a simple, clean, and timeless look. And this is definitely my favorite bit set for that. It really doesn't matter if you cut the tongues or grooves first, but since every single piece gets the groove, that's usually what I start with. With all the grooves cut, I could swap over to the tongue bit for both ends of all the rail pieces. You don't have to use a coping sled to cut these. You can just use a scrap piece behind your material to add stability and eliminate tear out. But if this is something you do often, I definitely recommend picking one of these up or making your own. This is just a cheaper one off Amazon, and it's always been great for me. One last thing to do on the router table was cutting a rabbet on all four sides of the center panels. Since I'm using 1/2 inch material here, we need to cut a 1/4 inch rabbet that'll fit in those grooves we cut in the other pieces. Now it's just a matter of adding glue to the tongues and getting everything clamped together. Something worth mentioning here is I had just the right amount of clamps to do all these, but you don't have to. Another good option is just using two clamps to pull your pieces together and then taking a 23 gauge pinner and shooting through the tongues from the backside to hold while the glue dries and allow you to take your clamps off and move on and do the same thing on the next. I know people watch these videos and think, man, I can't make that many doors unless I have $1,000 worth of clamps, or it'll take me forever just doing a couple at a time. This is just another example of there's always another way to do things, and you don't need or have to do exactly what those of us making videos on here are doing. Always feel free to leave me a comment if you're looking for another option to complete something that I'm doing. Moving on to the drawer boxes. I already had these cut to size from earlier, but I did still have to cut in the groove for the bottom panel to slide in on the table saw. I just made one pass in all the pieces and then bumped the fence over to make a second pass for the quarter inch plywood to fit. Here I'm trimming up the big drawer box that is going to house the clothes hamper just to slim it up and make it easier to pull the hamper in and out. Up next was the painstaking process of edge banding the tops of all the pieces. An edge banding machine is 100% in my future, but still plugging away here for now with the iron. I did set up a little assembly line to speed things up a bit though. By the time I got the banding applied to the last piece, the glue on the first one was cool and I could start back down the line with the trimming process. And then do it all again, and again, and again. Rocking with the pocket holes again here to put these drawers together, and it's just hard to beat this method. They're strong and quick, but most importantly to me is when you put the drawer front on, it's just a clean look with zero visible fasteners anywhere. At this point, I wanted to get the door hinges installed to check the fit, and this Craig jig is an affordable one that simply works great drilling out these hinge cups. I'm using Bloom soft close hinges here, and I'm doing inset doors and drawers, and these Bloom hinges are pretty sweet to work with the face frames. There's a little ledge on the clip that you just butt up to the face frame and screw it in from the back. Really simple to install. With these being inset doors, we do need to add a little stop, which I usually just use a little block of wood glued and nailed on from the inside. I almost always have the hardware picked out ahead of time too, so I can get those holes drilled before finish. Just less chance of marring something up doing it later. Everything got a small round over on the edges and lots of sanding, which I won't bore you with, but then I set up my little spray booth using the zip wall poles and plastic and got to finishing. For primer, I'm using my go-to Ben Shellac primer and my Graco 9.5 HVLP. And watching me spray white top coat on top of white primer is about as boring as watching me sand, so I'll spare you that as well. One last thing to button up before moving these to the house was getting the drawer slides installed, and since we have face frame cabinets, we do need to add spacers to push the slides out to clear the opening. I had this scrap piece of 1.5 inch thick countertop that worked awesome at allowing me to set both the spacers and slides on it to install. I installed the top slides in all the cabinets, then cut my block down and continued the same process installing the rest. Time to head in the house and get this thing installed. First, moving this particle board dresser out of the way. Psh, what the heck is that doing in a woodworker's house anyway? Now this house was built in 1960, so not ancient, but still pretty old. And there's a support post under this wall in the basement, right where I'm trying to install this. So everything sags away from that point, and I knew this wasn't going to be the funnest install. but I got everything set in place and initially leveled so I could scribe the two outermost panels that I was talking about at the beginning. I know with the lighting it's not the best to see here, but I'm using a marking knife attached to what are called mag shims to run along and follow the contour of the wall and cut this tape I have on the cabinet. Then I cut and sand right up to that tape line. I have the tracks all set with like a 5-degree bevel here to clear away as much of the material as I can. Then I can finish sanding right up to the line with a belt sander. Now with the two outermost cabinet panels hugging tightly to the wall, I could get the shimming finalized and get the units screwed together and into the wall studs. Just like the cabinet sides, there's 0% chance the wall is going to be perfectly straight for the countertop, so that needs scribed as well. I know I'm probably breezing through some of this, but I can't have this be a 3-hour long video. Some of these techniques could probably be standalone videos themselves, which I'm sure there probably already is a lot of if you want to search, but you will have to let me know down in the comments if those are type of videos you'd like to see me do. Now, because of this heavy, and yes, I know it's ugly, wall texture, it still needs caulked, but now it's nice and tight and not huge gaps. Here I finally remember to get a good shot before I added the tape, so you can see what we were working with to start, and then what it looks like after scribing. My wife helped me carry in, set in place, take down, carry outside, back inside, set in place again, the two tower cabinets, so she got a good taste of what it takes to get clean end results here. Installing the top panel and shelf was a breeze with those bolts and threaded inserts, and once those were pulled tight, I could get the whole unit screwed together and into the wall. Now to give this thing that true built-in look with the moldings wrapping around it. For now I am just putting the crown on the built-in, but I plan on continuing it around the rest of the room too, which I'll save to do an in-depth video on later. Those of you that are subscribed know from past videos I like to pre-assemble if possible down on the workbench, getting those corners glued and lined up nice and clamped to dry. I'm using tight bond speed set here, which dries in just 15 minutes, so while the crown molding set up, I went ahead and got the baseboard trim cut and nailed in place. And this right here is one of my favorite things to do. It's just such a satisfying feeling sliding that molding in place and it being a nice friction tight fit. On this hamper pull-out drawer, even though it is one big drawer, I'm still making it look like it's three drawers to match the rest. And here's another reason I like having those drawer pull holes already drilled. Makes it so easy to use those to screw through, to hold the front in place, to allow you to pull the drawer out to attach from the inside. I filled the nail holes and got the caulking done, but I do still need to do the final coat of paint here in these final shots, so don't mind any minor scuffs that you see. Actually was able to get it moved in and installed really cleanly, almost good enough not to have to do another final coat, But let's go ahead and get this TV installed, since some of you probably noticed and are wondering how that's going to work. First, I could figure out which stud was going to work best and get the wall mount installed. Now to actually plug in the TV. I built this to go in between two outlets on each side, so I could have used those, but that of course would have needed to be done before installing. But in the room right next to this one, there's an outlet almost right where I need it. All I had to do was cut out that box so I could reach in and drill through into the next stud bay over. Now back in my room, and that stud I just drilled through is marked with that leftmost piece of tape, I could cut out the hole for the new outlet. My wife was standing right there, so she went ahead and grabbed the wire while I was feeding it through the hole and then up to her. And that's a wrap on this one. Well, besides that final coat of paint that I'm sure I'll get to eventually. Hopefully you guys enjoyed the process. I know this was a long one. You guys know the script. I'd really appreciate a thumbs up, and hopefully you'll subscribe if you're not already. Until next time, take care.